Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 through 22. Normally, I would have you guys stand up and we would read the text and I would pray. But first, if I can ask you to do something, turn to Titus. Turn to Titus chapter 2, verses 11 to 14. Titus chapter 2, verses 11 to 14. For me, this is one of those underlining passages in the New Testament. Titus 2, verses 11 to 14. Let me read it to you. Verse 11. It says, "For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age." Verse 13, "waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works." Maybe you're in town and you meet up with a dear brother or sister in Christ, and maybe they go to a different church than you do, and you know, you have those conversations, and the conversation comes up, "Well, what are you learning? What are you studying on a Sunday?" And you let them know, "I'm studying Revelation." And there might be a response from them saying, "Why would you study Revelation? I mean, isn't it just so full of all these different pictures and events and things that might seem confusing? Why in the world would you study Revelation?" Friends, I truly believe Titus 2, 11 through 14 is the answer to that. Revelation teaches us how to wait expectingly for the coming of our Lord Jesus. Not only how to live in this present age, being zealous for good works, renouncing ungodliness, but having that expectant hope, knowing soon, at any time, Jesus is coming back for his bride. And this is the reason why we study Revelation. We have this blessed event coming, and we want to know, "Lord, I want to know, how do I wait expectingly?" And so this is why. This is why it's so good for us to study prophetic scripture, end time scripture, because it reveals to us just really how desperately we need Jesus. But also, friends, I think it spurs our hope. It motivates us to look forward. As hard as life is, as difficult as the obstacles that we face on a daily basis, man, hope is coming. Jesus is coming. And one day we will enter into a final inheritance. In Jesus' letter, in the beginning of Revelation, in Jesus' letter to the seven churches, he lines out so much of what he loves about these churches. Did you notice this as we've been studying in the last few weeks all about these churches, these letters from Jesus to these seven churches? He lines out so much of what he loves about the church. Ephesus, we saw, he says, "Man, Ephesus, your deeds are known, and I love how you just can't stand evil," right? And then he says, Smyrna, he says, "I want you to know that when you suffer, it has not gone unnoticed. I have seen your suffering." With Pergamum, he says, "Pergamum, you're so loyal to me. I love that you're so loyal to me." Thyatira, he says, "I've seen your progress. You were once here in the faith, and I've seen you progress in sanctification and in beauty." Sardis, the fifth church, he says, "Your reputation for being alive is so well known." And then lastly, before we come to our seventh church, he says, Philadelphia, "Guys, man, your love for the brothers is as if you love me." And I love this because, in a way, as we see this dialogue between Jesus and these churches, it draws me to remember that Jesus is the bridegroom and the church is the bride. So in a way, what we are experiencing as we're studying Revelation chapter 1 through 3 is a dialogue between a husband and a wife. And this, you know, makes me think about that because you guys remember this. You know, dating is not like marriage, right? Because when you're dating, you know, so much of your conversation is built up into the things that you love and the common unity that you have. Hey, you like Oreos? That's your favorite cookie? That's my favorite cookie too. Like, we're just so, oh man, what's your favorite movie? I don't know, it's this. Oh, it's mine too. And you find all these wonderful things in common and you're saying, I love this and I love this. And it's this back and forth of love, 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 love. And then you enter into your first year of marriage and it moves from, I love that you do this to, why are you doing this? Right? And there's these kind of, like in our family, we say come to Jesus moments where we say, you know, this is happening and some things need to change, you know? Normally, it's my wife that's saying that to me, like, because I'm leaving towels on the bathroom floor or something like that. And we end up finding out that we find this unity and intimacy together where we actually can air our difficulties and air these things that we have against each other. And that's a healthy thing within a relationship between a husband and a wife. And so, in a way, this is what I see here, because what's really hard or difficult to swallow is we come to the seventh and final church and we discover that Jesus' words are really the most convicting that we have seen so far. Really no encouraging word at the beginning, but instead a plea for a reignition of a relationship. I don't know, maybe you're sitting next to your spouse this morning and you've experienced that together before, where it was this come to Jesus moment where they said, if we don't reignite our relationship now, we are going to enter into a place where we are going to start disconnecting. And we need Jesus to come and mediate on our behalf and bring us back into fellowship together in the way that we were unified once before. This is what Jesus is saying to the Laodicean church. And this is what we're going to encounter together this morning, this dialogue of a relationship where he's pleading, come back, come have intimacy with me again. So let's stand, let's actually read the text. We're going to pray now, and then we'll just dive right in. Revelation chapter 3, verses 14 to 22. Revelation 3, 14 to 22. Verse 14, and to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. I know your works, you are neither cold nor hot. Would that you were either cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. For you say, I am rich, I have prospered, and I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. I counsel you, buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white garments so that you may clothe yourself, and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. Verse 19, those whom I love, I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. For the one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. Verse 22, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, open our ears, open our hearts, open our eyes. No matter what we are dealing with at this very moment, whether we would consider ourselves lukewarm or not, Lord God, your mercy is present, your faithfulness is present, and you desire to speak to us this morning. Lord, would you not allow us to hinder ourselves, to distract ourselves from what the Spirit has to say to us? And may you receive every glory, every power, every worship that is due your name. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. You may be seated. The book of Revelation, really its entire purpose, the whole reason for writing the book of Revelation is discovered very conveniently in verse 1 of chapter 1, right? the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show to his servants the things that must soon take place. It's the revelation of Jesus himself revealing to us what's going to happen in the future. Its foremost purpose is to reveal to those who read it, you and I, that Jesus actually is who he says he is. I mean, isn't this profound? That revelation is all about Jesus saying, all that I've promised in the Old Testament, all that I've promised in the New Testament is going to culminate into my fulfilling of every single thing that I promised you. That I am going to conquer evil once and for all. I am going to get all of the glory, and I will fulfill all of these qualities that you have spent your life engaging in and experiencing, participating in the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And this is what I love, because it draws me back to the Gospel of Luke, because Luke really, really focuses on the ministry of Jesus, that when he does miracles, whether he saves somebody from their illness, he heals them from their illness, whether he casts out demons, whether he raises from the dead, Luke's primary focus in saying these miracles is to declare that Jesus is dominator over sin and death, and that he will one day conquer it completely. And that's such an encouragement for all of us, even here in the very first verse of chapter 1 of Revelation, to say Jesus is actually going to do all of these things. Every hurt that you've encountered, every betrayal, every time you've been thrown in the meat grinder by this world, the flesh, and the devil, Jesus says, I'm going to redeem every single moment of that. And that's what we see here. It's his foremost purpose to reveal to us a blessed hope that we get to expect and be excited about. If I could think of a title that of Jesus that kind of references us to Revelation, I think we discover that in the prophet Jeremiah, in Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 56. I love studying the names of Jesus, because it just reveals so much of his qualities and of his power. Here we see in Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 56, it says this: for a destroyer has come upon her, upon Babylon. Her warriors are taken. Their bows are broken in pieces. For, here's the title of Jesus here: for the Lord is a God of recompense. He will surely repay. Every debt that you've ever felt, every being ripped off by the weight of sin, the flesh, the devil, Jesus says, I'm going to repay it because I'm the Lord of recompense. And this draws me to think, because It presents, and this is something that I think is personal for me, but when I'm normally when I read Revelation, it presents somewhat of a potential hindrance. And this is why. It shows a potential hindrance when we study Revelation. Maybe you go to a Bible bookstore, maybe you're searching on Amazon, and you're looking for resources that help you in your study of Revelation. Maybe you've searched YouTube videos to see, like, I want to see what this person says about Revelation. And to be honest, when I do that, I discover something that's a little bit concerning, if I can be so bold to say. A little bit concerning. Because the majority of resources that we see in Revelation, for the book of Revelation in Bible bookstores, is you look at the, I always look at the aesthetics. I do judge a book by its cover oftentimes. And what do I normally see on some commentaries or some books about Revelation? Huge flames, right, encompassing a world, right? Or like hands that are like crushing, you know, these buildings or something to that effect. And I don't know, I just don't get it. I go on YouTube, I put in Revelation, and the video that shows up, it's all like this spooky Halloween music for some reason that I just don't get. And it presents a fear for those that are wanting to study Revelation that say all of this is scary. Friends, the book of Revelation is one of the most hope-expanding books that we can ever encounter, because it shows that Jesus wins in the end. And you get to take a part, you get to participate in that victory, as we will see in the last verses here of our section. This is why Jesus describes himself in such a unique way to every church here in Revelation 1 through 3. And we see here, at the beginning, here in verse 14 of Revelation chapter 3, Jesus reveals himself to Laodicea with three titles. Let's look at that together. Verse 14 of Revelation 3. And to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the words of the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of God's creation. Three titles that describe himself to the church in Laodicea. I don't think Jesus minces words. I don't think what he says is inconsequential. And so when he's sharing with the church, writing this letter to Laodicea, he says, this is who I am, and this is who I want you to focus on me, these qualities and these characteristics. So when we ask, what do you mean, Lord? What do these three titles speak to your personhood, your character, your qualities in specifics to the church of Laodicea? Well, we see this in a very particular way. We see that Jesus, in the book of Revelation, declares he is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. What he says, what he does, who he is final. And these three titles encompass that. So let's look. The Amen, number one. What does Amen mean? Anybody? Jeopardy. So be it. I don't know why I said Jeopardy. What is so be it? So be it, right? It means, what is Jesus saying? He says, I am the Amen. I am the so be it. I am the final word of authority in your life. When Jesus says that he is the Amen, that means every time, every moment, every morning, you've gotten on your knees, you've worshiped the Lord, you've petitioned him with your needs. You've interceded on behalf of other people. Every time you've capped your prayers with the word amen, you are declaring, Jesus, it's your authority to fulfill all of these things. It's not mine. I give it to you. You do it better than I ever could. You even know the needs that I don't know. And you are here and present to bring mercy and grace and truth and redemption because you are the amen. You are the so be it. I'm not. And I'm just going to submit to that. Secondly, he says he is the faithful and the true witness. Almost as if to say, as the Amen says, you know, you're maybe worried about your future. You're praying about the future. Well, Jesus says, I am the future. I am the Amen. I am the so be it. My word is final. My authority is final. And then by him saying that he is the faithful and true witness, he's also saying, I'm aware of everything. And I'm faithful to you. Since I'm a true witness, I am not only in the future, I am also in the present. And I know what's going on. And I love the fact that here's this Laodicean church that has just that famous convicting statement that they are lukewarm. I don't want to jump ahead, but it's that famous statement that they are lukewarm. Does that take away from the fact that Jesus is faithful? Absolutely not. He's in fact merciful to them. He remains faithful because he cannot deny himself. And we discover that Laodicea is in the worse condition than any other previous churches mentioned, yet Christ offers his faithfulness, his loyalty, his steadfastness to them. Thirdly, he is the beginning of God's creation. Now, there are other pseudo-Christian cultic groups of people that would look at this text, look at this verse and say, oh, the beginning of God's creation, that must mean that Jesus has been created by God the Father. Friends, that's completely and utterly wrong. And the reason is understood here in the text. Because these people automatically assume that Jesus is this created being. However, the word, the beginning here, isn't the best translation for the Greek word arche, which we see. Rather, that word arche is understood as being the source, the ruler, the origin, and the fountainhead of all creation. Laodicea, let me just walk with me here. Laodicea, the town, was so very close to the city of Colossae. They were kind of neighboring cities. And we remember, when we hear that word Colossae, we should think, hey, there's a book called Colossians in the New Testament that was written to the church in Colossae. And so Paul's letter of Colossians was probably 30 years old already by the time that the Laodicean church received this book on Revelation. So they would know all that John is declaring, or that Jesus is declaring about himself, by saying he's the beginning of all creation, because Colossians has one of the most beautiful, I don't know, just mind picture scriptures about who Jesus is. Colossians chapter 1, verses 15 and 16. Many of us know this. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. He is the fountainhead of all creation. And I love this about the Bible. I love this about the Bible because we're studying the last book in the scriptures. But in this last book, I discover that it answers a question that we would ask ourselves all the way back into Genesis 1 if we were to ask it by looking at the first few verses. We remember those verses of Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and the earth was without form or void, and the Spirit hovered over the waters of the deep, right? So we're thinking Father, Son, Holy Spirit. There's God the Father, in the beginning was God, and the Spirit, he hovers over the waters of the deep. Where is Jesus? He is the origin, the fountainhead. He is the image of the invisible God. He is, in fact, where all good things originate from. And this is what we discover the more we study Revelation, is that it answers all of the questions, so many of the questions that we have previously thought of. I wonder where I can find the answer to that. And so he is the Amen, the future. He is the faithful and true witness, the present. He is also the beginning of God's creation all the way to the past. He remains the same yesterday, today, and forever. So why? Why did Jesus want the church of Laodicea to know that he is the Alpha, the Omega, that he is the beginning and the end, the source of all good things? We discover it here, and he relates to them now the convicting statement, verses 15 to 17. He says, I know your works. He says, you're neither cold nor hot. Would that you would be either cold or hot, but so, because you are lukewarm and neither cold, hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth. You know, Laodicea wasn't like Ephesus, right? Where Jesus tells Ephesus, you've forgotten your first love. If you would only remember your first love. They're not like Sardis either, when it says, you've forgotten the life-giving power, the presence of who I am in you, if you would remember that. No, what Jesus is saying with the church of Laodicea is even more damning. He's telling Laodicea, listen, you remember me. Laodicea, they remembered Jesus. They probably sung Jesus songs. They probably spoke about Jesus. They probably had interaction with others, and they said, how's it going? Well, you know, Jesus is right by my side. Things are going really well. But in reality, what Jesus sees is that they had a complete disregard of his authority in their life. Thus, they were lukewarm. They had no regard for the power and authority of Jesus in their church. And the scariest thing that I can think in this convicting statement is that a church can actually grow, actually benefit, by being in the midst of the world and completely denying the authority of Jesus Christ. Because this is, man, what a word picture. This word, lukewarm, it's unique here in this statement. It's not used anywhere else in the scriptures, this word lukewarm. It's only used right here in verse 14 through 17. And it kind of visualizes all the trappings of a church, yet Christ is excluded. Let me kind of relate to you maybe from a more cultural context about Laodicea. Laodicea, during the time of John, it was considered this vibrant, this wealthy, wealthy city. It boasted of its rich black wool manufacturing. It had this medical school that was just like the pioneering medical school of ointments and medicinal uses in its field. It was a city that offered retirement to seniors because it was somewhat of a resort town, and it had industry for younger people. But the biggest problem that Laodicea had was its infrastructure. Very practical problem. It didn't have the ability to tap into their own water system. So what they needed to do was gather neighboring cities' water and pipe it into their city. Now, two of the surrounding cities at the time was Colossae, which I previously mentioned, and they were known for their cool, refreshing cold water. And then onto the other side was this city called Hierapolis, and they were known specifically for their medicinal, rehabilitating hot springs. But it didn't matter which city that they took from, this water piping into their town, the moment that they were able to grab a bucket, fill up with water, drink the water, they would discover this water is tepid. It's lukewarm. And Jesus is revealing to them something so profound that they would know exactly what he's talking about. That the moment that they would drink it, they said, this is not refreshing like the cold waters of Colossae. This is not rehabilitating like the hot springs of Hierapolis. We have something, we have a product, we have something that just does not work. It is completely and utterly neutral. And it does not help us. And Jesus brings this example that they cannot deny. And so in a very profound way, he says, would that you be either cold or hot. He's saying it in this way, it's better that you would be almost ignorant of me completely. I'd rather you be cold than you to remember me and know me, yet deny me. Not live in the way as if I had a permanent place in your life. And this, these visuals of the cold and the hot, their lukewarmness revealed that they were just warm enough to say we're not dependent upon God, we can be dependent upon ourselves. They had just enough blessing to say, hey, we're rich. We don't really need anything. They had just enough comfort to say there's not really a need for prayer or dependency upon the Lord. They had all that they needed to do church, but they had completely excluded Jesus. John Walvoord says this. He says, there's something about the intermediate state of lukewarmness that is utterly obnoxious to God. Utterly obnoxious to God. Even to the point that it makes him sick. Man, just the thought of that is mind-blowing to me. Because I think, here's God. Does he get sick? No, absolutely not. He's perfect. He's holy. He's righteous. But he's telling them, your lukewarmness actually makes me want to vomit. It makes me want to spew you out of my mouth. It makes me want to disconnect you from me. Because you don't want anything to do with me, really. My name is constantly upon your lips, but I do not reside in your heart. And they say, for you say, verse 17, I am rich. I've prospered. I need nothing, not realizing that you are wretched, pitiable, poor, blind, and naked. They're saying we're rich. The church of Laodicea, they cry out, we are rich. We're in need of nothing. We have arrived. We are just a pillar within this community of Laodicea. We can say this mission is accomplished. Our significance has been found in our own accomplishment. And this is where it comes down to this convicting evaluation for every single one of us in this example of Laodicea. Because what did they really do? They've replaced Christ with the idol of their own significance. The idol of their own significance. And the scariest thing is that they're completely unaware that they've done it. Is that true of you this morning? It's that realization that if my significance is found in anything else but Jesus, then I have prescribed myself a life of misery and discontentment, even if I'm the richest man in Santa Maria. Even if I have the most significance within the city councils. Even if I have the best reputation amongst every person of authority in this city, if I don't have Jesus, I am lukewarm. And the Lord's going to spit me out of his mouth. This is the truth, friends. This is the realization, I think, as I get older, and maybe you've come to this realization before I have because you're older than me. Praise God if you have done that. It's this. Jesus is the only one. He is the only one on this earth, in your entire experience of life, who will not fail you. Your spouse will fail you. Your children will fail you. You know what? Your church is full of sinners. I don't know if you knew that. Your church is full of sinners, and oftentimes we will fail you. Your pastor will fail you. Jesus will not fail you. The church in Laodicea, they discovered that they can do fine in church without God at all. They can put on great events. They can entertain. They can have an awesome band. The pastor has some great jokes to give. They can actually grow in numbers and finances and be completely devoid of Jesus. On the outside, they are building maybe their third campus in the city. But in reality, they are poor, wretched, blind, and naked. And friends, this discussion, this dialogue between Jesus and the church can end right here in verse 17. You said you're rich. You said you've prospered. You said you have need of nothing. Well, guess what? I'm happy just to disconnect, and you can discover just how much you really have, how big your significance really is. Jesus has the authority. He would be well within his authority to condemn his church and say, guess what, Laodicea? You're on your own. You're completely devoid of me? Great, I'm going to be completely devoid of you. He's righteous, he's holy, he can do that. He says, I don't want to have any part with wickedness. And friends, that's so true for every single one of us as individuals. He can look at your sin, he can look at my sin and say, you know what, enough, I'm done. If he was not the faithful and true witness. If he was not the beginning of all creation, the amen, the so be it, and that his mercy is always available to people, to sinners. Laodicea, as far as Jesus was concerned, had completely lost their identity. They had this, they should have this, had this realization. Guess what, Laodicea? You are a lost cause, but Jesus loves lost causes. Maybe you're here in church this morning. Maybe you know what I'm just about to say to you right now. Maybe those two words are exactly what you think in your mind, in the inner dialogue of your heart, considering you and your relationship with Jesus. I'm a lost cause. No, friend. Mercy is here this morning because Jesus is here. Don't ever forget that he is faithful even when we are faithless. Even when we are lukewarm, he presents himself and he says, here's my redemption. Come. And be with me again. So praise God for verse 18 through 22. Look at what he says. Verse 18 and 19, he says, I counsel you. Notice he says, he does not say, I force you. He says, I counsel you. Come and buy from me gold refined by fire, so that you may be rich, and white garments, so that you may clothe yourself and the shame of your nakedness may not be seen, and salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. Those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. So be zealous and repent. Here's Jesus' faithfulness. Here's his title of faithfulness in action form. Remember, Laodicea, they're spiritually bankrupt. They are naked and they are pitiable, and Jesus counsels them, come and buy from me. I am the source of every good thing. Come and buy from me. But friends, if we pick this apart, don't we see kind of the insanity of it for a moment? Maybe you're placing yourself in the midst of being Laodicea and you're saying, yeah, I thought I was rich, but I've totally disregarded Jesus' authority in my life. I am shamed. I am broken. I'm pitiable, I'm blind, I'm naked, I'm poor. How can I buy anything from Jesus when he says, come buy from me? How can they buy when they are naked and broke? But this is the beautiful thing about Jesus. He not only provides the riches, the clothing, he provides the means by which to pay for them. He actually takes his white garments off of himself and actually clothes you in his own righteousness if you were only to say, yes, I repent. He clothes you from your nakedness. He puts on the riches of his goodness and his grace. And he says, if you want to come buy from me, I will provide the means by which to pay for it. Your white garments are paid for by the blood of Christ himself. You know, there was another Laodicean church in the Old Testament. It was the nation of Israel. Israel was disobedient to the Lord that they left their first love in a big way. They started worshiping pagan altars. They started sacrificing their children on these pagan idols' arms. They started dealing with weird sexual immorality. And Jesus proclaims to the nation through the prophet Isaiah, if you would only come to me. Look what Isaiah says in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 1. And this is to every single person in this room that thinks that Jesus can't save them because they're too far. Jesus says this, come. Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters. He who has no money, come buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without price. If you only want it, I'm happy to pay for it. One summer when I was really young, maybe 7 or 8, we were going on a summer vacation as a family, and we were going to go camping, and my dad collected my sister and I, and it was the morning of when we were just about to jump into the Jeep and take off, and he hands us a crisp $20 bill. And to a 7-year-old, you know, to have a crisp $20 bill, man, it's like $1 million, right? And my dad says, this is for your vacation. You get to spend it on anything you want to. And my mind is like, anything, like kill my gut with candy, buy toys, like whatever, like $20. What can buy with $20? And give it to my sister as well. And we were just so excited. And on the way up to camping, we stopped in this small kind of town that had gift shops and things. And so we were just kind of perusing around. And we went into this gift shop that was just full of these beautiful ivory sculptures of like marine life. And and I was just in there looking at all these sculptures, and it was just a fun time. We were just perusing things that were so well above what we could afford. And as I'm looking at one of these sculptures, I don't know that the hood of my sweatshirt has caught on the fin of this dolphin sculpture behind me. And so you know what is going to happen. I take a step forward, and I just hear right behind me a poof, and just an absolute crumbling of this dolphin sculpture. And I just like completely aghast, like what is going, my parents aren't around, they're somewhere else in the store, and the clerk comes up and I'm just so ashamed, it's completely broken. And her only thing she says to me is like, well, I can give you a discount on it. And I was so, I can't do it. And I pull out, all I have is $20, which is like, I don't know, a 50th of probably of what it costed. And my dad comes over, and he sees what happens, and without an angry word, he picks it up, he says, I'm going to pay for it. And for the longest time, seriously, for the longest time it's been in his office, that we glued it back together, put it back together, and it's been in his office for up to this point. And I was ready. I was here. Here's my $20. This is all I have. And my dad says, no, keep it. This is for your vacation. This immense value that I had no capacity to pay for. My dad comes up and he says, I'm going to pay for everything. I'll pay for it all. For your failures, for your mistakes. He didn't say that. For your failure. You know. Not at all. Friends, that's so true of Jesus. He not only provides the means by which to be saved, he is the salvation. He is the payment and he is the prize. He has done everything necessary for you to be saved, to cover your shame, to extinguish the curse, to adopt you to himself. In fact, you need to do your darndest to push yourself towards hell when he's done everything necessary to save you from it. This is why we're here this morning. It's because we have been saved in this grand affirmation that we can't pay for salvation. Jesus needs to pay for it for us. He gives us gold. He gives us his white garments. He gives us the salve to anoint our blindness and open our eyes. Greg Nelson did such a beautiful teaching over the course of the weekend for men's retreat last weekend. He said something that was just so profound to me. It just struck me like just a punch in the face. And he says, Christ has done everything to save us, that in order for you to get to hell, you have to step over his own tortured body. It's Jesus who has done everything necessary. Yet, so often and not, we take off these white garments, we take off these rich rings, we take off the salve of our own eyes and say, you know what, I'd rather have my own significance. I'd rather do my own thing. I'd rather find my reputation in what I want to do, not what Jesus wants to do. And I remove my identity from him. Friends, Jesus is not speaking to unbelievers here in the Church of Laodicea. He is speaking to believers. And he is saying, if you are lukewarm, I counsel you. I ask you, please come and have relationship with me again. My mercy is available to you this morning. If you would only come and be zealous and repent. This is so interesting. Verse 19, those whom I love, I reprove and I discipline. Man, isn't that so against the world? The world says, if I love you, I'm just going to give you anything that you want. I'll let you become your own person. I'll let you decide your own significance. But Jesus says, if I'm perfect and my plans are perfect and my timing is perfect, my orchestrations are perfect, wouldn't you know if you identify with me completely that you're completely stable and you don't need to lean on your own significance and your own reputation? So he says, because I'm reproving you and disciplining you, Laodicea, be zealous in repentance. It's almost as if he's saying, Laodicea, you've never been zealous a day in your life. But if you're going to be zealous now, please be zealous in repentance. Because I'm present here and now. Jesus is here, present now, to bring us back into accord with him. Verse 20, he says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and eat with him and he with me. And isn't that illustration so soberingly clear? There are people who claim to know Jesus but don't know him, and he's knocking at the door. But again, remember, friends, this is the Church of Laodicea. These are believers. And he's saying, guess what? There's a door that's separating you from me. Something that you have put up, not me. A boundary between you and I. And I am just a gentleman enough not to break it down and wait for you to answer that door. So often not, when we hear that text, we often think that's for unbelievers. That's a gospel message. Hey, he's knocking at the door. You should answer and get saved. Friends, a lot of us as believers, we need to get saved. We need the door. We need it to open the door in order that Christ can come in. Let me just share with you just something real quick, too. We had recently, we had a funeral of a dear, dear brother within our body who passed away, and we were just rejoicing in his life and rejoicing in the goodness of God. Many people, a lot of people were here. Pastor Patrick was leading the funeral, and he just did such a great job. You know, funerals are a great place to share the gospel because everybody's thinking about eternity. Everybody's thinking about death. And it's a great opportunity to share the gospel, and Pastor Patrick just did, man, such a great job. And then afterwards, there was this time where, hey, a microphone is up. If you want to just share a memory that you had with this guy, we would love to hear it. And so this guy comes up, and he's kind of like, you know, I don't know what that pastor was talking about. I'm a sinner. It's no big deal that I'm a sinner. And then he said something profound, which to me, as I was in the back, I was listening, I was like, whoa. He said, yeah, I hear Jesus knocking. I'm just choosing not to answer. And you know, all this range of emotions in my mind, you know, start coming out, like thinking, you fool. And then all of a sudden my heart broke in pity. Because here's the reality, friends, for every single one of us, the mere fact that you can even hear Jesus knocking on the door is his mercy and his grace. You don't have to hear it. He doesn't have to knock on the door, but it's because he's faithful and he's true and he loves you with an everlasting love that he's knocking. And I'm praying for that guy. I'm happy that the Lord is knocking on the door of his heart, because at one point he's going to know. Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is God. Verse 21 to 22, as we come to a close, we need to do communion together. It says, the one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne, as I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers. Friend, that's you and that's me if you're a believer in Jesus Christ. You share in a conquering that is not your own. You share in a conquering that is Jesus and Jesus is alone. You share in the throne that he alone has been able to ascend to. And this makes me think, you know, ladies, on Friday mornings, Tuesday nights, you guys are going through the book of Hebrews. I'm so pumped that you guys are going in the book of Hebrews. Because really, at the very beginning of Hebrews, is this really grand, triumphant event. And it's as if it cuts right from the gospel of Jesus' ascension, and it cuts to the place where Jesus actually comes into heaven, and it's this dialogue between God the Father and God the Son, and it's just like mind-blowing. Because he looks at the Son, he says, come, sit at my right hand. Be mediator between God and man. He says, because of what you have done, because of your redeeming power, because of the blood that you shed upon the cross, I have given you a name that's above every other name. You are King of Kings, you are Lord of Lords, and come sit at my right hand. And when I read that in Hebrews, my skeptical brain comes up for a moment. And I ask the question, well, what's the big deal? You know, Jesus, he's God. How can it be that he's given these gifts? He doesn't need anything. He's God. He doesn't need any extra names. He's God, right? What's so powerful, what's so amazing that God the Father would say, come and sit at my right hand, come and sit at my throne. And then this realization comes in this full, like just this full illumination of looking at Scripture. This is the first time you will see in Hebrews, the very first time that humanity sits on the throne of God. Jesus himself, and because Jesus, both man and God, sits at the throne of God himself, he is able to open those doors to give you bold access to his throne of grace. That every human being that says Jesus is Lord and has been saved by his blood is able to enter into that throne room, a throne that once was judgment is now a throne of grace. And this is what he's saying here. Not only that, the one who conquers, I will grant him to sit with me on my throne. I feel my unworthiness when I read that. I don't deserve to sit on his throne. As I also conquered and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. This is my plea to you as we come to a close this morning. Friends, in reality of declaring I want my own significance, in declaring that I want my own identity, in declaring that I want my own reputation, you are exchanging an eternity of riches, an eternity with Jesus sitting on his throne for a mere breath for you to say, I'm doing my own thing. Your lukewarmness is separating you from intimacy with a God who loves you so much. The spiritual health of you and me, the spiritual health of this church, is solely dependent upon how close we lean up against Jesus, how close we listen to his voice, how close we apply his teachings, how close we align our affections to his face. The moment we stop talking about Jesus in this church, we're already dead. It's my prayer for us this morning.